twice so that the Zoom audience hears it. Hello again. Welcome to the Zell Visiting Writer Series Reading and Q&A with our distinguished poet in residence, Rick Barot. My name is Michaela Coatsiers, and I am your series coordinator for the year, and now just today and tomorrow are my last events. As for just a bit of programming and what we do, the Helen Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to University of Michigan each year to meet with our public readings, craft talks, and Q&As, and the series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. And this week, we are very fortunate to have poet Rick Barot visiting us on campus. I know that our students and myself included so far have just been really impressed and grateful for his generosity and conversations. So just for a few administrative announcements before we move on to the reading, note that this event is recorded and will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writer Series YouTube channel, so you can rewatch it or share it with a friend later on. If you're joining us on Zoom, you can enable closed captions by pressing the CC icon on the bottom right of your Zoom screen. And Jen will also be posting a copy of Rick's reading in the Zoom chat board. And then for the minute, MFA student will introduce Rick. After that, Rick will give a reading for about 20 minutes. Around 6 p.m., another MFA student, David Villaverde, will have a 20-minute conversation with Rick. And for the last 10 minutes, we'll open it up to audience questions. So if you're joining us in person, you can line up at the mics on either side and we'll signal to you the question. If you're on Zoom, you're welcome to also submit questions via chat, and Jen will read those aloud for you. And that's all for announcements. So I will hand it over to Chris for Rick's introduction.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Welcome to this room. I'm going to do a non-traditional introduction and lead us through a quick mindfulness practice. So I want you to settle into your seat, get comfortable, relaxing your shoulders and jaw, shake it out. Take a deep breath. Close your eyes if you'd like. Still your mind. We will soon hear the illuminating poetry of Rick Barot. Barot's poetry welcomes us toward thoughts that arrive to us suddenly, thoughts that we might find while being mindful and observant, thoughts that are clear and revelatory. If a passing thought comes to you as I speak, think for a moment about what it might mean, as Barot does in his poems. What might this thought be connected to? Does it propel you to take action? Make a mental note about what you must do, and take another deep breath. Let it settle naturally, like the end of an ocean wave. Imagine one of my favorite images from a Rick Barot poem, a cerulean tarp on a neighbor's shed. How does that tarp move in the wind? If a tarp is holding bricks in the back of a truck, what color is it in your mind? What things can a tarp not cover? What ideas cannot be sheltered or do not have shelter? Scan your beautiful brain for ideas and investigate your attention. This is what Rick Barot asked us to do in his work. It helps me interrogate the degree of attention I give to certain ideas, memories, and people, and why. Then follow me to this quote from Barot's poem, Virginia Woolf's Walking Stick. I've come to understand that the test of how well a thing is made is to look at the places where its parts come together, joints, seams, corners, folds. Seams and corners of Rick Barot's poems develop and look and feel like this. Bring your focus to what you think the most faraway galaxy might look like in a photograph. Imagine the hands that are holding that picture. Then consider that the most faraway galaxy might look like dust in the corner of a window pane. And then there's more. Be excited for Rick Barot's poems that take you from the furthest edges of the mind and universe to something as close as your own hands. You're about to be immersed in worlds and philosophy. An idea of his starts as a seed and grows into a tree with thousands of branches that keep multiplying long after you read or hear his work. be excited for the connectedness of Rick Barrett's poetry. It compels me to dig deeper into what it means to be part of a community, a family, a world, and what I should do with the knowledge that I'll gain and how I can revere it. And as we near the end of our mindfulness practice, I'll share one of my favorite things about Rick Barrett's book, The Galleons. The collection reminds me that while people, desires, or tangible things may be far away physically or in the scope of time, they have a direct impact on us and what we're doing right now. Rick Barrett creates reading experiences with the foundation of discovery, and he is about to read for us. So when you're ready, open your eyes, if you had them closed, and return to the room. Rick Barrett was born in the Philippines, grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area, attended Wesleyan University, the Writer's Workshop at the University of Iowa, and was a Stegner Fellow at Stanford University. He is the author of 4 books and a chapbook titled During the Pandemic. He has been published widely in places such as Poetry, The Paris Review, The New Yorker, and Tin House. He's received many accolades, including the Catherine A. Morton Prize, the Tom Gunn Award, and the Shelley Memorial Award from the Poetry Society of America. Barrett currently teaches at Pacific Lutheran University, where he is the director of the Rainier Writing Workshop, MFA. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Rick Barrett.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Is that better?
Better now.
Okay, good. I can't see you, but you can see me, I hope. It's so wonderful to be here. Thank you so much to Chris for that generous introduction. And despite the mindfulness moment that he just gave us, I'm very nervous, which is probably a good thing. And I hope that what I'm about to read will live up to the hype. I also want to thank the poetry faculty of the Helen Zell Writers Program for the invitation to be here this week. I'm also really enormously grateful to Michaela Kotziers for the enormous amount of labor that she did to make my visit such a successful one. So let's give it up for Michaela. And I would like to dedicate this reading to a dozen or so MFA students that I've had the pleasure of meeting one-on-one this week. It was such a gift for me to read their poems, which were so beautiful and complicated. And I'm really grateful for that chance to be immersed in their work and also to have had the conversations that I've had with them. So thank you very much to those of you who I met with. So I'm going to read some poems from my recent book and also read some new work as well. And then I look forward to the conversation with David and with you. Let me put my timer on. So the first poem that I would like to start with is called The Girl Carrying a Ladder. And I don't think I need to say anything about it beforehand, except that I've brought in Louis Vuitton into this poem. The Girl Carrying a Ladder. On the same day I read about the luxury goods company that has produced a punching bag you can buy for $175,000, I see the photograph of the Palestinian girl who carries a ladder with her each morning when she goes to school. To scale the wall of my own understanding of why a punching bag would cost so much, I have to think about why I'm attracted to that punching bag the way some people are attracted to pink kittens, or the way some people are attracted to camouflage, or the way some people are attracted to their gods. I want that punching bag the way the girl carrying a ladder wants to go to school, relentless, single-minded, and absurd. Carrying the ladder that is twice or three times as tall as she is, leaning the ladder against the wall that separates her from her school. The girl goes up the ladder as though it were something she did every day, which she does. When I think of a punching bag, I think of sex. When I think of a ladder, I think of picking apples. When I think of the girl carrying the ladder to go to school, I think of the neighborhood girls carrying pink camouflage backpacks, not knowing about the armies that the camouflage stands for. The logo of the luxury brand is printed all over that punching bag, the way camouflage is all over us. Camouflage bedsheets, camouflage cell phone covers, camouflage shirts in neon colors that everyone wears, even the people who vote against guns. We live in paradox and prosper. We live in paradox and thrive. What I can't figure out is how the girl deals with the barbed wire at the top of the wall she has to go over, or what her ladder weighs, or what she does with the ladder when she gets to school. Does she put it against a wall with the other ladders, the way kids put their bikes in bike racks at school? What I can't figure out is why two men who look like gods would want to break down the wall of each other's faces, knowing there's only blood on the other side, or why apples are the fruit children bring to their teachers, and why it isn't grapefruit or coconuts, or why the neighborhood girls on their way to school each morning carry backpacks that are so heavy, it looks like they're carrying the world. So I'll mention in a bit of bitterness that Louis Vuitton actually produced a limited edition of 25 of those punching bags. And you would get boxing gloves with it and jump rope as well. And they sold out on the darn things, as they would, of course. So the title poem for my book, The Galleons, is comprised of 10 poems, and I'm going to read the first and the final poems from the sequence. The book is an elegy for my grandmother, ostensibly, who died at 92 years old in 2016. And she's the woman referred to in this first section of the title sequence, called The Galleons One. The Galleons One. Her story is a part of something larger. It is a part of history. No, her story is an illumination of history, a matchstick lit in the black seam of time. Or no, her story is separate from the whole, as distinct as each person is distinct from the stream of people that led to the one and leads past the one. Or her story is surrounded by history, the ambient spaciousness of which she is the momentary foreground. Maybe history is a net through which just about everything passes, and the pieces of her story are particles caught in the net. Or her story is a contradiction, something ordinary that has no part in history at all. If history is about what is included, what is made important. History is the galleon in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, in the middle of the 16th century, swaying like a drunk who will take 6 months to finally reach his house. She is on another ship, centuries later, on a journey eastward that will take weeks across the same ocean. The war is over, though her husband is still in his officer's uniform, small but confident among the tall white officers. Her hair is marcelled like a movie star's waves, though she has been too sick with the water's motion to know that anyone sees her. Her daughter is too, the blur of need at the center of each day's incessant rocking. Here is a ship, an ocean. Here is a figure, her story, a few words in the blue void. So I need to mention that a couple of days ago, when I was having lunch with some of the MFA poets, I I shamelessly disclosed that that poem that I just read is actually borrowing from a poem I deeply love, Brigitte Begin Kelly's Dead Doe. If you know that poem, you'll recall that that poem is a series of revisions. Yes, no, yes, no, yes, yes. And I've loved that poem for, you know, decades. And I've always wanted to write a poem that paid homage in some way to that poem. So if you know that poem, you can probably see the resonance between the two poems. What do they say about, you know, poets borrowing and stealing and all that? So I really encourage that. The next poem I'm going to read is The Galleons 10, which is the final poem in the title sequence. And as Chris mentioned, I was born in the Philippines, and we immigrated to the United States when I was 10 years old. So this poem is about my Filipino heritage and my childhood in the Philippines. The Galleons 10. I come from the lowlands. My mother's city was built on the river where the mountains fanned out to the sea, and the city thrived there. I come from farmers. I come from childhood's green radio, from the calachuchi tree and its white flowers. I come from prayer. My parents took me to a faith healer once, though no one now recalls the malady or the terms of the cure. I had a faith. It took me across an ocean. It has taken half a life to turn back and see what it was I left behind. I come from teachers and soldiers. On the island where my father comes from, the people covered their bodies with tattoos. I come from soot, from ink. I come from people who honed their teeth to sharp points, who buried their dead in coffins shaped like boats for a journey. I come from horizon. I come from water. So the last poem that I'll read from The Galleons is an ode to the beautiful old house in Oakland, California, where I spent part of my growing up. And this house is about 100 years old, and my parents have been in it for about 40 years. So it's interesting for me to think about this house as a place that is haunted, but haunted not by other people, but my own earlier lives. So this is a poem about that haunting. This is called Ode with Interruptions. Someone is in the kitchen washing the dishes. Someone is in the living room watching the news. Someone in a bedroom is holding a used stamp with tweezers and adding it to his collection. Someone is scolding a dog, barking now for decades, a different dog for each of the decades. Someone is reading the paper and listening to a baseball game at the same time. At the base of the altar, you drop some coins into a wooden box, and the lights reveal the vast worn painting in front of you. The holy subject is illuminated for a few minutes before it is dim again. There are churches all over Italy where you can do this. The smell of incense, stone. Someone is taking the ashes out of the small cave of the fireplace, though this might have been 100 years ago when the house was new and we didn't live in it. Someone is writing a letter on thin blue paper. Someone is putting down the needle onto a spinning record, just so. On the couch, someone is sleeping. Upstairs, someone is looking into the bathroom mirror. While we were waiting for her surgery to finish, I walked around the hospital and came across a waiting room that had an enormous aquarium. The black fish with red stripes, the yellow fish with blue stripes, the triangle fish, the cylinder fish, the little orange schools and the cellophane glints of their quick turns in the box of water among arrangements of coral, the city of bones. Someone is walking down the creaking staircase in the dark, a hand sliding on the rail. Someone is on the telephone, which means nobody else can use it for another hour. Someone in his room is doing homework, me or someone almost like me, 20, 50 years ago. Someone is reading in her room. Someone is talking to the gray wall. Someone is talking to the gray wall. In summer, on a hot afternoon, someone peels at a corner of wallpaper and sees more wallpaper underneath. I used to think that to write poems, to make art, meant trying to transcend the prosaic elements of the self, to arrive at some essential plane where poems were supposed to succeed. I was wrong. So those are the poems from the Galleons that I'll read. I'm going to end my reading with some poems that are new, that are from a new collection that I've just finished. And part of this collection is comprised of a series of 30 prose poems that I wrote called During the Pandemic. And each prose poem starts with that phrase. And I wrote these in March 2020, at the very start of the pandemic, when it was incredibly scary at that time and isolating. And so my way of therapeutically dealing with the moment was to start composing these little poems using the Notes app on my phone. And frankly, that's why they're prose poems, because you can't really do lineation in the Notes app. And so these are some of the poems from that sequence. I'll read maybe about five or six of them. And each one begins with the phrase during the pandemic. So you'll know when I moved on to a new one. During the pandemic, I fixed on each fear. Each fear was its own fastidiousness. My mother and the ocean, not even a touch of it, not even her feet in the tender edge of surf. My friend and the tunnels he went through with his eyes closed. When we went outside, we wore latex gloves, the colors of Easter. We stood apart in the mandated distance, like the last pieces at the end of a game of chess. During the pandemic, I kept a list of possible symptoms on the refrigerator door. From a distance, it looked like a shopping list, an ersatz normalcy, fever instead of flour, cough instead of bacon, fatigue instead of milk. With each day, the slippages proliferated, hospital instead of hospitality, projections instead of protections, virus instead of virtue. Asymptomatic veered towards asymptote, an intimate infinity between them. During the pandemic, I looked out the window at the moment a runner went by. His stride had an exaggerated beauty, like everything that was outside of my mind. The blue recycling dumpster, the white cereal bowl, the pink full moon. Inside my mind was woe, an attic full of gray insulation. During the pandemic, I knew we were in a period of interval, so I considered what an interval meant. The interval we were in was not like swinging on a hammock on a summer afternoon. It was not like making a lesson plan to be taught. It was not even like being inside a car wash and its cleansing tempest. It was more like Lucky's speech in the middle of Beckett's play, its torrent of rage and grief, after which the waiting, which was the point after all, resumed. during the pandemic, I wanted to take up as little space as possible. Wake, wash, eat, clean, watch, lie. I wanted my habits reduced to a ritual of monosyllables. The painter said, a skull is a beautiful structure and used to waiting. I admired the painter's suave severity, that grim style. Now that isolation and obedience were what I knew of refuge. During the pandemic, I thought of scale. Pandemics, I read, had shaped human history from the start, like lava scorching an old landscape with regularity. That was one kind of scale. The tweet from the man announcing his wife's death from the virus was another kind of scale. Soft, the size of my face. The mask I wore to the grocery store was one kind of scale. The racist violence being done to people who looked like me, that was another kind of scale. A scholar wrote, the poem is the speech of citizenship, and I laughed. During the pandemic, I went outside as into an abstraction. Every body was a vector. Every public space was a possible inflection point. The very air was a moral injury. But there was no abstracting this. The bus driver died, the shoemaker, the chef, the playwright, the nurses and the doctors, the ambassador, the princess, the leader of the band, the scholar of Derrida. This is the last that I'll read. Thank you all so much for listening. During the pandemic, I praised the cherry blossoms. I praised my lungs. I praised crying. I praised the faces of my students checkerboarded on the computer screen. I praised the curses I gave to those who deserved them. I praised coffee. I praised ventilators. I praised the people gathered on the rooftop of a nearby building, laughing as they looked up at the night sky. Thank you so much. I'm very proud of myself. That was exactly 20 minutes.
Rick, first of all, I want to thank you for such a lovely reading. And perhaps indemnify or absolve us, I'm going to ask you some potentially facile questions. But it is not my fault as an interlocutor. He has asked me to ask him very easy questions. He's had a tough week.
It's been a hard week.
Yeah. So I thought I would start off with something that was really, I think, interesting to my students. We had read Chord, but we also talked about your poem, UDFJ 395462 84, and I was wondering, here we are in UMA, if you'd had a chance to see the Wiley piece that's right here. Not yet?
Not yet. I'm really disappointed that I didn't know about the collection here until today, actually. But I wish I had known, and I don't have the time.
Well, you'll have to come back.
I will, I hope.
So much of your work, I feel, deals with art in interesting ways. In one of these poems you just mentioned, Waiting for Godot, Francis Bacon appears, so many different artists, Don DeLillo's White Noise. There's fiction, there's playwriting, and there's lots and lots of visual art. I was wondering if you could speak to the nature of your relationship to art as an artist, and if that differs at all from your relationship to art as Rick Barot, the human being.
Uh-huh. I think there are really two dimensions of art that that I'm drawn to as a poet. One is that when I see other artworks rendering the world in these marvelously aesthetic ways, I'm drawn to that and the pleasure of that. But I'm also drawn to the way artists render the world in dimensions that have to do with, you know, the ethics of being a person moving through the world. I think that a lot of my poetry has always had the ekphrastic impulse. And what I've noticed over time is that in my earlier poems, I just tended to take for granted that beauty was the primary experience that I was supposed to have with these artworks. And so I would encounter them, and if I wrote about them in my poems, it was just to celebrate the kind of the aesthetic pleasure of that encounter. But as I've moved through time, and I've kind of arrived at a different sense of what art can do or should do. And so there's a poem in The Galleons that's about Las Meninas, that very famous painting by Velázquez that's in the Prado. And that poem is about the objects in that painting that are actually referring to the kind of colonial plunder that Spain was engaged in during the time. There's a clay jug in there, and historians of material culture have traced the fact that jug was probably made in Guadalajara, which was a center for clay making or pottery making in the empire. And there's a silver tray in there and other silver items. And that tray was probably extracted from a mine in Bolivia. And then there's a red curtain in there, which was probably dyed using cochineal, which was extracted from cactus plants in Spain. So, you know, that's the kind of perspective that I have now about artwork, that there are these, you know, encoded into the art that we see these days, or the way that we look at art these days, there are these other sort of ways of thinking about what that art represents and what it encodes, which is a very different place from where I was early on, where I just took it for granted. It's about feeling beauty and, you know, elation in front of this piece of art. I'm in a very different place now. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I kind of wanted to go off of that a little bit because in the way that kind of the Galleons draws a through line of colonialism through capitalism, much of your work, it does seem situated in terms of being a participant or an onlooker in a museum, something that I identify with. Mm-hmm. And you'd mentioned the Prado, and I know you'd gotten to travel to Spain. In that project, do you feel that your relationship to museums writ large changed? There's an interesting exhibit upstairs where they're talking about basically repatriating pieces of art of unknown provenance, mm-hmm. And determining the provenance of things that they acquired, because many museums are accumulations of capital, whatever we want to call it, that were achieved through empire and colonialism.
Right.
And I was wondering how your relationship with these centers of beauty or these concentrated places that we go to see it has evolved as your work has evolved.
Well, I think it has to do with this idea that nothing is innocent. Anything that you look at with a kind of a critical eye, there's some aspect of that thing that you're looking at that is, you know, soaked in blood in some way. I do this thing with my students. I teach a writing 101 class at my university. And one of the first things I do is that we take a random object from the room. And this is me sort of helping them to think about what critical thinking might be like. And so we'll take, let's say, this water bottle, and I will ask the students to write down on the board what are the prospective majors that they're thinking about doing while they're at the university. So we'll have somebody who's interested in, you know, religion and philosophy and design or economics or business or anthropology. And then we ask, so taking this object that's in front of us, what does each of those disciplines think about this object? How do they see this object? the economist looking at this water bottle has a very particular take on it, right? The person who's studying industrial design has another take on it. And so that kind of critical, multifaceted way of thinking is something that I'm always trying to cultivate in my students and certainly in myself. And that obviously extends to any kind of space or situation or institution that I'm interacting with, including museums, where the default posture that you're supposed to have as a person in that space is one of, there's a kind of suspension of disbelief that you have to engage in, and you have to buy into the kind of the pleasure that you're supposed to feel there, right? But if you actually activate these other parts of your thinking while navigating through those spaces, you get to have the pleasure, but you know, there's also all kinds of problematic things that are going on in those institutional spaces, including museums.
Thank you for the very erudite answer. I was wondering, in a similar vein.
You never look at a water bottle the same way.
In a similar vein, you read The Girl Carrying a Ladder, and it feels to me in some ways one of the hallmarks of your work is a self-implication of the speaker of the poem. And I was wondering if you saw that as a continuation of how you, we were just speaking in the museum, or viewing yourself as a citizen of the world.
Mm-hmm. No, it's all connected. I mean, that the poem, you know, it starts with that Louis Vuitton, that item, that, you know, this amazing punching bag that's $175,000. Think about all of the things that you encounter on a given day, and try to understand how all of those things are actually connected with each other, because they do. You know, the advertising for the punching bag, the image on Facebook of the Palestinian girl carrying a ladder to go to school, looking outside and noticing the girls walking to their elementary school carrying backpacks that are in this camouflage pattern, and what that camouflage stands for. I mean, it's all connected. And so the poem is trying to do a little bit of that juxtaposition without necessarily letting you know explicitly how they're connected. And that's what I've been trying to do a lot of in my work, just sort of putting things side by side by side, and then allowing the reader to sort of lean into trying to figure out how does the camouflage relate to the Palestinian girl, and how does that relate to Louis Vuitton and luxury goods, because they're all connected.
Yeah, speaking of the interconnection, you read The Galleons 10, and which is one of my favorite poems of yours. I was wondering if you would give us another perhaps peek behind the veil, if the refrain of or the anaphora in that poem, is that also borrowed from let's say, you know, you'd mentioned Galleons 1 riffing off of Bridget Pigeen Kelly's Dead Doe. Was that taken for somewhere else, or was that all you?
That was all me. There okay. should be a little TM beside that poem. what I'm finding in a lot of the poems that I write these days is that I'm always trying to create a kind of invocational music, because I'm starting, I write very seldom, I have very little time to write. And I've come to see the times when I do write as almost a kind of a ritual space, because I'm so busy otherwise. And so when I start to write, that the writing begins to take on this musicality that I associate with ritual. And so when I was writing that poem, the kind of chant-like quality that appears there, that was only because I had a half hour to write. I wanted to write something, and that poem presented itself. And so it was a kind of a quick way of formally getting the poem going, and it worked. So I kept it that way.
I'm wondering about the evolution of these sort of rituals as they varied from project to project. Your newest project that you just read from seemed to vary wildly from The Galleons, or The Galleons are all in couplet form, and it all seems kind of, there's a certain operant logic there, in the same way that there felt to be a certain logic as a through line in Chord. And in your new work as well, do you feel that after you've completed a project, you find a new mode to work in, or the ritual kind of evolves from project to project?
I was talking earlier with some students about this notion I have that as humans, we're content generating machines. Whether you're a writer or not, you're every moment you're generating content of some kind, psychological content, emotional content, intellectual content, physiological content, right? So if you're alive, you're generating content. What makes, I think, writers and artists different, not special, but different, is that we have this incredible impulse to kind of make little shapes, containers, and we scoop some of that content that's relentlessly unfolding, and we park it into these shapes, which might be poems, which might be a song or a short story or an essay. So what makes the writer, I think, different from everybody else is that impulse to kind of preserve or safekeep some of that content in these shapes. And so for me, I always take it for granted that I always have content, but when I'm thinking about a new project or a new book, I'm obsessed with what new or cool or interesting shapes can I come up with where I can kind of put some of that content in to preserve it, to kind of house it in there, like in a safety deposit vault. So in the new poems that I read, that the kind of the pro formal project where had to do with the prose poem and that phrase. How much of that phrase could I use over and over again and create that kind of that rhythm that seems very monotonous, but in fact is dynamic because each one after that phrase is invoked is very different from poem to poem to poem. So I think that, you know, for a lot of poets, it's really, you know, content is kind of cheap. It's always there, but the geeking out over form, that to me is what really makes the poetry. What can I do to make an interesting new shape for all of this stuff that's already in my head?
Yeah, I'm wondering about, in a similar vein, as you continue to produce more content. We had an interesting conversation in my thesis workshop today where we talked about perhaps our own ambivalence or own lack of ambivalence towards our previous work and how that evolves through time. Do you find as you're creating more content and embracing more formal restraints and play that when you look back at what is your relationship with the stuff that you've created 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago? How does that change?
Oh God, that old work is like the old boyfriend that you don't want to think about. No, I think I know that every writer has a different relationship with their previous work, but mine really feels as though the new work feels like a repudiation. It's a moving onwards without a looking back. I'm going to leave it at that. I'm embarrassed by it.
That's fair. The exes can stay in the past. I was also wondering when I was reading the Galleons about the formal constraint of the couplet is it feels like in many ways that on the surface it's doing one thing, but it belies in fact many of the formal gambits that you're embracing, including using guzzle-like terminal caesura, using continuing sentences that are and jamming across these spaces. And in many ways, it felt to me where you were actually embracing a wide diversity of form within one formal constraint. Do you feel that those type of challenges, which feel like intimidating to someone in my position, are sort of kind of the tying one hand behind the back of mastery? Was that a challenge that you gave yourself specifically to see how far you could take it? In the same way the pandemic poems?
Yeah, so the Galleons, all of the poems in that book are in couplets. And that was a decision that I made very early on and very stubbornly. I decided I'm gonna keep it all this way. And so I gave myself this very kind of rigid prescription. But what I learned was that that actually forced me to be kind of creative in within the parameters of the couplet. So there are all kinds of formal gambits happening in those poems. Even within the restriction of a couplet, there are poems that are not punctuated or poems that are doing interesting things with syntax, or there are poems that are sort of layered in interesting ways. So what I learned was that actually, you know, having my one hand held behind my back was that, you know, I was using this hand, but I was also using my mouth. You know, I was using my feet, my elbows to do all kinds of things to move through the work of writing those poems. And I really enjoyed that. It made me realize that, you know, writing a poem is a little bit like being Robinson Crusoe on his island. You know, I need an umbrella today. I don't have the stuff to make it, so I'll have to improvise in some way. So that kind of resourcefulness and perhaps even ingenuity, that was activated when I gave myself those very strict rules.
Yeah, also speaking to form and rigidity, I mean, much of your work is very graceful and punctuated by command and control. But I wonder, you also have a wonderful way of letting go and how you balance those impulses in crafting a poem of knowing exactly the moments to loosen your grip, essentially. I hope that's not too esoteric.
Was there a question in there?
Yeah. How do you let the loosening happen exactly?
Well, the way I think about a poem or a whole book of poems is that you're making the reader experience a series of modulating intensities. And so figuring out how those intensities are being orchestrated in a given poem, you know, how do you affect a certain kind of maybe ease or restfulness? And then how do you lead up to something that's more dramatic or climactic? And so just sort of, you know, noticing how you can do that through imagery or sound or metaphor or surprise. So I'm always aware of, you know, all of those sort of like instructions that I'm giving to the reader in the course of a poem or in the span of a whole book. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I'd like to open it up now to the audience and to all of our Zoom listeners. If they have any questions, to feel free and come up and either approach any of the mics over here or pop into the Zoom chat. Oh, wonderful.
A Zoom question.
Yes, hello. I'm going to be reading and representing for the people in Zoom. And this question is from Patricia, who asks, I see that the During the Pandemic series was published but sold out in 8 hours. So the obvious next question, where and when will it be republished? I'm a COVID survivor with 2 years of COVID under my belt. I really want to have these poems where I can hold them if that's possible.
So I did just finish a whole manuscript of poems, and this is going to be one part of that book. I have not sent the manuscript to my publisher yet, so I have no idea if they'll take it or when the book will be published. And so, Patricia, be patient.
Yeah, do we have more questions on the Zoom? All right, my students, if you don't ask a question, I'm going to fail you all. So get up here and approach these mics. I actually have a question. Wonderful.
Okay, so Rick, this is actually kind of in thinking about a few days ago when you were mentioning that you had curiosities about the ways that other writers have been sort of responding directly to writing during COVID, or kind of writing as if it's not happening. And they're kind of like, yeah, there are just various ways that people are doing that or not. And so I'm curious too, after hearing poems from your During the Pandemic chapbook, which I really loved, to hear you talk more about one, maybe how your practice of writing poetry has changed or like continued to change during the pandemic. Like I love this idea of kind of experimenting with form, like through writing in different places and like with different objects and software. If you could talk about maybe your practice and also content of your writing and how that's been changing throughout the pandemic.
No, I think the conversation that we had about was my wondering about how the pandemic experience was impacting different writers and the way they thought about their own writing and the content of their work. Because some writers I know are taking it head on as subject for their work, and some writers are just sort of pretending that it never happened, knowing that it'll probably come in at some point and that they need the time to process and to understand how to render that experience, an experience, by the way, that we're still in their writing. And I think this is probably the same way with 9/11, that there were writers who immediately sort of galvanized their creativity to address that moment in history and time. And then there are other writers for whom it took years, decades, to bring that into the space of their writing. I feel lucky in the sense that the pandemic poems that I read, I didn't think that they were actually going to be poems that other people would see. It was purely therapeutic. It was me just sort of messing around in the notes app of my phone, pointing or putting down sort of bits of thinking and phrasing that felt like sort of like all this electricity was in my system, anxious electricity, and I needed to sort of like touch something so that some of that electricity would just sort of disappear out of my own body. And so that was me just sort of needing a way of, I think, physically and also psychologically dealing with just the trauma of the day-to-day experience of it. Another impact had to do with the fact that I did write it on my phone. And that helped to further demystify for me the process of writing. And for a long time, I'd already started to demystify and de-ritualize my writing in the sense that I had to kind of be able to write anywhere, whether it was in my car parked in front of the supermarket, or at work in my office between appointments. In the past, I needed to kind of have perfect sort of circumstances for my writing to happen. But I've really arrived at a place where it's very opportunistic. I have to do it where I can do it, because it's the only way I can do it. And doing it on the phone was just kind of a culmination of that. And it made me happy that I could, in fact, write things on the phone. So I guess from a content standpoint, it was really a wonderful experience in that way. And from the technology part of it, it just affirmed that, writing happens when it needs to. I don't need sort of like, the mood lighting and the right atmosphere and the right beverage. I just have to do it when it comes.
All right.
Hi. I wanted to ask a little bit more about the process of you writing like on your notes app. I use my notes app for a lot of different writing things. And I recently kind of just started to go through them, and it dates back like 5 years. And so like sorting through it and trying to organize it has been a bit of a process. So I wanted to hear a little bit more about your experience, like using something where, yes, like you could do it anywhere, but like because of the nature of like that's how you're writing, like how did you organize it all into like a cohesive piece at the end?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the first part of what you said?
Oh, I was just saying that I write a lot of things in my notes app, and that I've been trying to organize it, and it's just, there's a lot of scattered things. And so since it's not like a journal or something, it's like, there's just so much in there. I wanted to hear about more of your like process of taking all these pieces and putting it together.
I see. Well, just read through the things that you have and do, you know, do maybe what I call a heat reading. Like, what are the parts of the bits and pieces that you have that have a lot of kind of energy and dynamism? And then maybe move them to, you know, a regular notebook or to a Word file and kind of just, you know, go through the stuff that you have and evaluate what seems to be really has a lot of potential. And then move it over into a more maybe formal space where you know you're going to write something, whether it's a poem or, you know, a song or an essay, so that, you know, you kind of prioritize the good stuff and then work from there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
All right, I think, yeah, come on up.
Hi, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Cool, thanks. So one of the things I noticed in my year in your work is how much you intentionally leave out for the reader to decipher on their own and how it increases the meaning. One of the examples you mentioned earlier was the connection between the punching bag and the camo and the ladders. So I was wondering, how you honed that skill in your practice of leaving the significance to the reader to decipher while still conveying all of your ideas.
Mm-hmm. That is sort of the question for, I like to talk to my students about how we as writers are kind of in the business of providing instructed thinking to our reader. And so the question is, how much instruction do you actually give them? So I'm giving you, you know, these elements to ponder, to think about, but I'm not necessarily giving you sort of, I'm not coaching you or over-determining how you're going to see those things in relation to each other. But there's really kind of a spectrum of intentionality that I think I can deploy in each poem. There's some poems that are maybe more narrative, wherein the reader's movement through the poem from point A to B to C, that's really organized and clear for them, because the story has to be clear, because there are other things happening that are complicated, but they need to kind of fundamentally understand what the story is, right? But in a more maybe associative or meditative poem like the girl carrying a ladder, I think that the kinds of zigzagging or the kind of pivoting that the reader has to go through there, that maybe the difficulty even that the reader has to experience there, that's as much of the content as the content. The feeling of kind of disorientation maybe that you might have, or the feeling like you've got to kind of do the work to make those parts connect to each other, that's as much of an important kind of intention on my part for you. So, but it's different from poem to poem. But what I hope when I write any poem, I think, is that as many of your kind of response centers as possible are activated as a reader, your sense of your own senses and also your emotional and intellectual selves are involved. So hopefully that, you know, from poem to poem, you feel as though it's not just your mind that's sort of involved in the interaction with the poem, but also your whole body. And because I think that the more of that that the reader feels, that their whole body is involved, that's an intensification of pleasure for the reader, I think. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you for the question.
All right, I think that's all the time we have. That's going to conclude the Q&A, and I'm going to turn it over to Michaela, who's going to give some closing announcements. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick, so much for a really beautiful reading, and also for being, again, generous with all of your answers during the Q&A, and thank you, Dave, for facilitating it. I want to say thank you to Chris as well for giving us a really nice mindful exercise in the opening introduction, and to Jen for co-hosting on Zoom as always. As a reminder, Rick will give a craft workshop tomorrow morning from 10 to 11 a.m. titled The Face of the Beloved, and that will be happening in person in Angel Hall 3222, or you can join us on Zoom using the same link that you did for tonight's event. You can also sign up for our email list, either at the sign-up sheet that's right outside the doors here in the auditorium at a table, or by following the link that Jen will drop in the chat. And last announcement is that you can buy Rick's books from Literati, Ann Arbor Locals Bookstore. And as far as I know, in addition to ordering extra stock for our author visit, Rick has also stopped by and signed all of the copies that they have on their shelves. So you can still get a signed copy if you did not bring one tonight for Rick to sign. So thank you again for coming out, and enjoy the rest of your evenings.